And there was evening, and there was morning, an uncommonly lovely spring morning. My small, sleepy village was just waking from its sweet slumbers. Imperceptibly, as though with angels' wings, the silent earth was astir. Fully awake now, my first thought was boozy. Again, boozy? Yes, once and again, boozy. Again and yet again, boozy. Over and over again, boozy. But talking about Boozy makes me so happy that I never grow tired of telling stories about her, telling again and again who Boozy is. I once had a cousin named Benny. He drowned in the river. He left an orphaned daughter. She was called Boozy, short for Esther Liebe, Lee Boozy. And she was as beautiful as the Shulamite of the Song of Songs. We grew up like brother and sister. We loved each other like brother and sister. That's who Boozy is. Years passed. I went away from home against the will of my parents. I disregarded their wishes. Refused to follow their ways, pursued my own path instead. Once, before Passover, I got a letter from my father. Congratulations! Boozy has become engaged and will be married the Shabbos after Shavuos. We expect you home for Passover. I returned the good wishes and hurried home. Boozy was in full bloom. She was beautiful, lovelier than ever. And in my memory, there blossomed the Boozy of old, the Shulamite of the Song of Songs. But a storm raged within me, and a fire kindled in my heart, a fire directed at no one but myself. At myself and my boyish dreams, so foolish and golden, for the sake of which I had forfeited happiness. Because of my neglect, Boozy would be someone else's bride and not my own. Boozy had always been dear to me. But when I came home and saw Boozy, I realized that I loved her. I loved her with a holy, flaming passion. Boozy had blossomed like a rose. But that morning her eyes, her beautiful Song of Songs eyes, were misty. A thin veil covered her face. There were many things I wanted to know.
"Do you want to know about him?"
she said, lowering her eyes.
"He's a wonderful man, simply wonderful, and he's kind. Yes, he's a very kind man, but..."
She raised her eyes and smiled at me. "He's not fit to be compared to you. How can he possibly measure up to you?" What did Boozy mean by this? Was she making fun of me? No. Boozy was unburdening her heart. It was as clear as day. After drinking tea, Boozy came into the room, parasol in hand, and called to me.
"Come. Where?"
"To the outskirts of town. Let's take a walk. It's such a beautiful day." "Well, are you coming?" The finest music, the most beautiful symphony, could not have sounded as lovely as those words. In them I imagined an echo of the Song of Songs. Meadow before us, clad in its green mantle and adorned with the gems of its rainbow-colored field flowers, was bordered on one side with a silvery stream and on the other with a small but dense wood. Intoxicated with joy, I followed Boozy. I felt I was walking on air. What was bothering Boozy? This was the first time since I had come home that she had invited me for a walk. What was bothering Boozy? Boozy wore a soft blue dress, light as a breeze, transparent as air and sky. The village was far behind us. Do you remember, Boozy, when we were here last? It was the eve of Shavuos, Boozy replied, and presented me with a bouquet of sweet-smelling flowers. For you, she said, looking at me with her beautiful blue Song of Songs eyes. I gave her my hand, the first time since I had come home. Hand in hand we crossed the bridge. I breathed the familiar scent of her beautiful hair. I felt the tender smoothness of her exquisite hand and the warmth of her body. And I dreamt that I could hear her saying the words of the Song of Songs. Boozy looked like a flower, like a rainbow-colored flower in that rainbow-colored field which extended endlessly about us in the distance. Boozy looked at me wistfully, her eyes as deep as the forest. What was she thinking now? What were her beautiful blue eyes, her pensive Song of Songs eyes saying now? That's what her eyes told me, and it seemed to me that never before had Boozy been as much like the Shulamite of the Song of Songs as she was today.
Is over and gone.
Boozy was inordinately gay today. Unnaturally gay. She laughed as though she had to. It was time to talk. Time to open up my heart, to reveal my inmost soul to her. And I expressed my thought in the language of the Song of Song. That morning, I laid bare my heart to her. I swore to her by the stream and by the forest, by the lovely blue sky mantle above us, and by the golden sun which sparkled in our eyes. I swore by everything that was bright and beautiful and holy, that I returned only because of her. Only because of her. For I loved her. Finally, the word tore out of me. I love you, Boozy. Do you hear me? I love you. Boozy was weeping. Boozy wept
and the sun ceased to shine, the stream to flow, the forest to green, the birds to sing. Boozy wept. She hid her face in her hands, her shoulders trembled, and her weeping grew more and more frantic. So would weep a child who sensed that he had lost his parents. So would weep a devoted mother whose child had died. So would weep a girl who mourned the lover who had deserted her. So would weep a person who blamed himself for letting his world of happiness slip through his fingers. Boozy refused to be comforted. Boozy refused to hear the song of songs. Her. Too late did I see there was someone named Boozy. A Boozy who now had a heart which yearned and a soul which longed for another sphere. Stopped weeping, and everything came to life as before. The sun shone as before. The stream flowed, the forest greened, the birds sang. Boozy stopped weeping, and her eyes, her beautiful song of songs eyes, were dry. At that moment, Boozy was proud and beautiful, magnificently beautiful, more beautiful than ever before. I continued my song of songs and took her by the hand. Return to me, Boozy, return to me while there is yet time. I have another word, just one more word to say to you. But Boozy did not want to hear the one word I wanted to tell her. We had spoken enough, she said, perhaps more than we should have. Enough. But the tone of her voice rang uncommonly strange. The voice I heard, it seemed to me, wanted to overcome, outshout another voice, the one deep within her. As clear as day to me. Look how late it is, Boozy said, pointing to the sky. Come, let's go home. And in her last phrase, I heard the voice of long ago echoing with a song of songs.
Dear, upon the moon.
Days passed. Weeks flew by. The beloved holiday of Shavuos and the Shabbos after Shavuos came and went. So did another Shabbos, and yet another. And I still remained. Every day I walked alone beyond the outskirts of town, past the bridge to that rainbow-colored field, to the same slope where the two of us had sat. That same slope where once, many years ago, the two of us, Boozy and I, ran like young gazelles and leapt like deer upon the mountains of spices. And what happened to the Shulamite of my song of songs romance? What happened to Boozy? How did it end? Don't press me to tell you the end of my romance. An ending, even at the very best, always contains a note of sadness. But a beginning, even at the very worst, is better than the finest ending. Therefore, it is easier and more pleasant to tell you the story from the beginning, once and twice and even 100 times, and in the same fashion as always. I once had a cousin named Benny. He drowned in the river. He left an orphaned daughter. She was called Boozy, short for Esther Lieber, the Boozy. And she was as beautiful as the Shulamite of the Song of Songs. We grew up like brother and sister. We loved each other like brother and sister. And so on. A beginning, even the very worst, is better than the finest ending. And so, let this beginning also be the epilogue to my romance, a true story which I have taken the liberty to call The Song of Songs.